Hello, dears. Today we can discuss the pathology and classification systems of neurogenic bladder dysfunctions. First, we can look into voiding dysfunctions at various level. First is suprapondine level, where the lesion is seen above the pons. Then suprasacral level, that is lies between pons and the sacrum, and sacral level lesion, which is usually seen at the sacral level and infrasacral level. It includes conus and caudaicona lesions, and peripheral level lesion, which includes lesion at the pelvic level and bladder level. Then first we can look into the suprapondine lesion. This is usually seen in conditions like stroke, traumatic brain injury, Parkinson's disease, multiple sclerosis, tumors, etc. In acute stroke, there will be usually urinary retention. This is due to the presence of cerebral shock. After the cerebral shock disappears, there will be detrusor overactivity with uninhibited bladder contractions. This is due to the release of the spinal micturition reflexes from the inhibitory higher pontine micturition center and facilitation of excitatory control. The sensory system usually will be intact in these patients, and the patients will experience urinary urgency and increased frequency with detrusor overactivity. Now we can move to the suprasacral level. Here the lesion will be seen between the pons and the sacral cord. Usually seen in conditions like spinal cord injury, transverse myelitis, multiple sclerosis, spinal cord tumor, etc. If the lesion is above sympathetic outflow, there will be both internal and external sphincter dyssynergia. There will be detrusor overactivity, and there will be absent or reduced sensation below the level of lesion. If the lesion is below the sympathetic outflow but above the sacral level, there will be internal sphincter synergia. Usually the patient will be in spinal shock immediately after injury. In that state, there will be absent somatic reflex activity, flaccid muscle paralysis, but the smooth internal sphincter will be functional. This causes urinary retention. In these patients, spinal cord injury patients, during the time of spinal shock, normal guarding reflex will be absent. So we have to look to know little bit of guarding reflex. Guarding reflex is actually a storage reflex. During the storage of urine, the distension of the bladder produces low level efferent firing. Efferent firing in turn stimulates the sympathetic outflow to the bladder outflow through the hypogastric nerve. It causes the contraction of the outlet and it inhibits the detrusor action. And through the pudendal nerve, it produces the external sphincter contraction, which causes the closure of the external sphincter. This is called guarding reflex. This is also seen during cough. Then comes the suprasacral level. We can see the disruption. There is disruption of the function of the urothelium. Main function is forms a barrier from protecting the inner stroma. And the beta receptor predominance in the body of the bladder is changed to alpha receptor predominance, and alpha receptor causes contraction of the muscles. Similarly, M2 receptor predominance is changed to M3 receptor, and the patient will be having denervation supersensitivity. That is, when the smooth muscle is denervated, its sensitivity to neurotransmitter increases, and there is a change from small myelinated A delta fibers to unmyelinated C fibers. Normally, in a normal bladder, A delta fibers will be acting and C fibers will be in a silent state. Whereas in spinal cord injury, the C fibers becomes more active or it gets wake up. This we have discussed in the previous class. There is also increased release of ATP from bladder urothelium and nerve growth factor from spinal cord. Now, moving on to the sacral level lesion, usually seen at the level of sacral cord or below. Usual causes are spinal cord injury, IVDP, tumors, AV malformation, and canal stenosis. The lesion can present as conus lesion or a codicona lesion or a combined conus coda lesion. External sphincter is usually not affected as the detrusor. Why? This is because even though the nerve supply is same as the detrusor S234, the external sphincter is not affected. This is because nuclei are located in two different positions of spinal cord. Detrusor nuclei is at the intermediolateral column, whereas the pudendal nerve nuclei is at the lateral ventral gray matter. Second explanation is that sometimes pudendal nerve has got a supply from S1 level, that is one level above, that is S1. Moving to the peripheral level lesions are seen in diabetes mellitus, herpes zoster, Guillain-Barré syndrome, pelvic surgery, etc. In diabetes mellitus, usually affects the efferent pathway. The patient will be having a sensory neuropathy. Whereas in a herpes zoster, it usually affects the efferent fibers. And the patient will be having a motor neuropathy. Whereas in pelvic surgery, both sensory and motor neuropathies are seen. Both are affected. We can have an overview of pathology. The lower urinary tract dysfunction could be at the level of bladder or at the outlet, or it can be even combined. First, we can look into the filling or the storage failure. This may be due to bladder overactivity or decreased outlet resistance, or can be due to altered sensation, or it can be a combination of what. Second is the emptying or the voiding failure. This may be due to decreased bladder contractions or increased outlet resistance, or can be a combination. The treatment can also be classified under the broad categories as to whether they facilitate the filling stage, storage, filling or the storage phase, or the emptying or the voiding phase, and whether the treatment drugs acts mainly on the bladder or at the outlet. Now, moving to filling or the storage failure. Main cause is bladder overactivity. That is, there will be involuntary contractions or decreased compliance of the bladder. The possible pathophysiologies of overactive bladder are reduced suprapontine inhibition, damaged axonal paths in the spinal cord, loss of peripheral inhibition, enhancement of excitatory neurotransmission in the micturition reflex pathway, increased lower urinary tract efferent input, decreased stimulation from the pelvic floor, or it can be even idiopathic. Second is, the storage failure may be due to altered sensation. In the absence of overactivity, storage failure may be due to increased efferent input from inflammation, irritation, or other causes of hypersensitivity and pain. It can also be due to chemical, psychological, or idiopathic causes. Increased efferent activity may be responsible for true detrusor overactivity or true urgency without detrusor overactivity, or a premature feeling of fullness or distension without urgency, or detrusor overactivity or a sensation of pain during filling. Third is the decreased outlet resistance. This may be due to the damage of the innervation of the smooth or striated sphincter or both. It may also occur due to the damage of the pelvic floor also. Now moving to the treatment of the filling and filling or the principles of treating the filling or the storage failure are, we can inhibit the bladder contractions, or we can decrease the sensory output, or we can increase the bladder capacity, or we can increase the outlet resistance. Now moving to the emptying or voiding failure. Mainly it is due to bladder underactivity. This is due to the failure or impairment in one of the neuromuscular mechanisms necessary for initiating and maintaining a normal detrusor contraction. It can be due to outlet overactivity or obstruction. Usually this is secondary to a failure of relaxation or active contraction of the sphincters at the time of detrusor contraction, which this causes, if this is this happens, this causes detrusor sphincter dysynergia. Can be due to an anatomic obstruction also. Now we can move to the treatment of emptying or voiding failure. The principles behind are, we can increase the intravesical or the detrusor pressure, or we can facilitate the micturition reflex, or we can decrease the outlet resistance, or a combination can be used. Then after neuro-urological evaluation, we have to classify the lower urinary tract dysfunction. A good classification system will help us to have a better understanding and helps in better management. Ideal system should include clinical symptoms, conclusions from urodynamic studies, and helps to assess the type and site of neurological system. Most classification present today are to describe the lower urinary tract dysfunction secondary to neurological disease or injury. At present, there is no ideal system which is perfect. This is a picture showing the simple functional classification. First functional system classification. Here there is failure to store and failure to empty. Little more expanded form. This is the expanded functional classification of the lower urinary tract dysfunction because of the level of bladder and at a failure to empty. This is the functional categorization of therapy to facilitate urine storage or bladder filling. We can see that it is can be bladder related or outlet related. Here, behavioral therapy, pharmacological therapy, electrical stimulation, surgery, etc. can be used. This is another classification which is functional category. This is another classification in which there is categorization of therapy to facilitate bladder emptying or voiding. Similar one which uses the external compression, pharmacological therapy, electrical stimulation, and surgeries. This is a urodynamic classification which helps us to which is on the basis of objective urodynamic data. And this is classification is proposed by International Continence Society, ICS. This is actually an extension of urodynamic classification system. Here the storage and voiding phases are explained separately, and in each phase there is bladder and urethral function. Other classification systems also. With this, we are ending this class. Next class will be on pharmacology in lower urinary tract dysfunction. Thank you.